So thank you for having me here. My presence here on this cushion is quite unexpected. So I had about 10 minutes of preparation time. So I will just speak hopefully from the heart and do justice towards sitting on this cushion. The only thing I really have to share is things about my own life, my own experience, because what real knowledge do I actually have? And I just want to share a bit about my path and how it has been going. So about 7 years ago, the right causes and conditions came together for me to start practicing Zen. I had a friend who was 18 years old when he was diagnosed with brain cancer. And unfortunately, we had to say goodbye to him very fast. So I learned at a very young age that life can be very short and unexpectedly you can die very fast. But actually, one of the great things about his death was that the way he died so peacefully and he literally looked like an angel. The moment he was there on his deathbed, he was already dead. He was literally glowing like he transcended everything. And that had a very profound impact on me. Then some other things. I was 17. I was in Berlin. I went to one of those underground parties, you know, very hard techno. And somebody offered me some ecstasy. And I was young and enthusiastic, so why not, you know? So I tried. I even got caught in a toilet, but even the guard said, okay, you know, you do your thing. We don't want to hear any noise from you tonight. Have a good night. So the right causes and conditions came again together for me to have a very interesting experience. And I felt so much love at that moment. I felt like this love was already there. It was already in the inside somewhere, but I just needed to tap into it with the right tools. And the only question that really arose in me was, how can I feel like this for myself if this is already there? And then the third and last sort of thing that needed to come together for me to start practicing Zen was, I had this deep feeling that I wanted to explore the world. And I told one of my teachers, I was studying architecture, that I wanted to go abroad. And I was thinking, you know, maybe Denmark, maybe Sweden, like safe countries within Europe, within the reach of family who could probably visit me. And then a couple of weeks later, one of my teachers told me, do you want to go to China? And I said, you know what? Why not? And I just did it. What we learn here from Zen Master Sung Sun, just do it. Just go straight. I did that. I don't know why. And 2 days before I actually left to watch China, I realized I'm going to China. And in China, I don't have my friends. I don't have my family. Everything that I identify myself with won't be there. And then it started to hit me and it hit my mind very strongly. And actually I cried for almost 2 days. I had a girlfriend and she wasn't not really happy with me leaving. And then the moment I stepped into that plane, I really realized everything I have, my whole context is gone now. So who am I? And this question, who am I, really came very deeply into my mind. And all the time I spent in Shanghai at this architectural company, I was just thinking, okay, I'm here in this company, but who am I? What am I doing here? And well, we all know that we talk about Zen, but in Korean Buddhism, it's called Sun. But actually it originates from Bodhidharma going to China where it's called Chan. So I was in China, the origin of Zen, and I stepped into this Buddhist monastery in the middle of Shanghai. I was just curious, looking around. And I saw this Buddha and he looked so peacefully. And another hit in my mind was made. So I had this friend who was dying very young. I had this experience of this love within me. And then I suddenly have this big question, who am I? And then I saw this Buddha sitting there very content. And I was very curious. Why is he smiling like that? You know, it's like the Mona Lisa. He's just sitting there very peacefully smiling. And sort of the right things just all came together. And I Googled something, how to meditate, and I start sitting on the center of my bed. And after 2 or 3 weeks, I had this very intense experience of being sucked into myself, like a vortex. And I was just being sucked into this black hole, and suddenly everything seemed to disappear. And then I started thinking, wow, this is so cool. What is this? And then, of course, the whole experience vanished. And then the weeks after that, I tried to recapture that experience. But of course, if you want something, you'll never get it again. So I was lost, but at least it was like there was this call from the inside, you know, like somebody said, like, okay, there is something else than just the things that you experience in the mundane world. besides worldly life. And so I was triggered even deeper. And then another very interesting experience happened. I went on Skype with my parents, because of course they missed me and I missed them. And suddenly my dad was in front of the computer, looking at me through the screen. I was in my little room in Shanghai, looking outside, seeing all the skyscrapers. And I asked, "Dad, are you okay?" And suddenly he started to cry. And, you know, as a man, you're not supposed to cry. And especially when your dad cries, it really hits your mind really strongly. And my dad never cried, so I was crying as well. We were both crying, and I sort of needed to learn how to cry in China. As I just told, when I left, I cried for almost 2 days. And I was a strong man, so I never cried. But the moment I went to China, I started crying again. And I started feeling things again, so that was very beautiful. And suddenly, there was this feeling of immense sadness. My dad crying in front of me on the computer screen, and I asked Dad, "What's going on?" And he said, "Well, I have a burnout, and I'm completely exhausted. I don't know what to do with myself." And I just found this, this meditation thing, and I was being pulled inside, and I had these big questions. So I had, "Dad, I'm meditating now, and it's amazing. I feel so peaceful and calm, and there are all these things like, we have this whole universe on the outside, but I found there is this also this universe within. So maybe you can do something with it." And then he started to do some mindfulness practice. I was doing my Zen practice. Well, I tried to do something that's called Zen practice. I don't know what I was doing. And then the moment I left China, I got this book from a friend. It's called Zen Mind, Beginner's Mind. Probably many of you know it. And I read it and I couldn't get my head around it. Like, what is this man talking about? So I was trying to meditate. I had this book and all the causes and conditions came together for me to start something. So I came home and my friends literally said, "There was a Joris before you left. And after you came home from China, there was a completely different man." And I was just gone for 4 months. But after that, I started devouring books. I emailed one of my old teachers, my Dutch teacher. And I knew he was into meditation, so I asked him, "So what should I do? I have all these questions and I try to meditate, but what should I really do?" And he was an experienced Zen teacher. So he told me, "Okay, try not to read any books or not too many, and really try to practice and meditate and find a good teacher." So what did I do? I didn't find any teachers and I started reading books like crazy. And I just practiced how I thought practice should be, So of course, it got me somewhere, but not really far. I can expand on that. But basically for the last 7 years, I've tried to sort of get better at practice and try to practice and try to do something that we call Zen, which I still have no clue about what it really is that we're doing here. But now I'm sitting here on a pillow. And this is basically a brief introduction in my life and why I'm practicing Zen. And why am I actually here? So the last 1.5 years, all these causes and conditions that came together led me deeper and deeper into myself. And I really started to think, okay, there is something more behind this all. So after I finished university, and I taught 1 year in university, I had some money. So I decided, okay, I'm going all in. I'm going to Korea. I'm going to this monastery, Musangsa it's called, where they practice Zen. And I'm going to do my first kyolche. And basically all the experience I had was a Vipassana retreat of 10 days and 2 sessions in the Netherlands from a Japanese tradition. And I had a 10-day retreat in India, which is called Introduction to Buddhism, which was just philosophy. And suddenly I was sitting in this hall, 3 months of meditation. And then I really realized I had no clue what practice actually was. And the first 2 weeks were quite easy for me because I knew I can do this. I know how to practice. I was sitting there like, very tight. I know how to do 10 days. I know how to do 7 days. And then suddenly after 2 weeks, my stomach started being very upset. And every morning I was sitting like this, like very tight. And my stomach was sort of okay. And then after breakfast, it started to become like a bit worse. And then after lunch, even worse. And in the evening, I could barely sit anymore. And I start skipping some of the evening meditations. And then I think I had 2 weeks of intense agony and pain. Every morning started fresh. And every evening I started with even more and more pain. And then after 2 weeks of that pain, I just fell down in the kitchen while doing the dishes and I couldn't stand anymore. And I started to cry, again, the crying. And one of the monks, one of the Sunims, was of course shocked. What is happening? What, are you okay? And I said, oh, 2 weeks of this pain. He said, 2 weeks? Go to your room now, have rest. And then there was this new guy, and of course you're not allowed to talk. And he came in and he looked at me and he said, I've been seeing you for 1 week and you look very tight. I think you're too hard for yourself. And he left the room and the door slammed and it hit my mind. I've been too hard for myself my whole life, basically. I always go 110%. Never 100%, never 90%. All that one, always 110%. And then the next day, I had to go to the bathroom about 6 times in 2 hours. And all the agony flushed out. And suddenly, all the stress went out. And finally, I was sort of in a relaxed state in the kyolche. So that was a very interesting experience as well. And now, that kyolche, of course, led to this kyolche. And who knows how many kyolches will come after this. Sometimes even the thoughts and feelings of becoming a monk start to arise, and then they go down again, and then they come up again, and then they go down again. So we'll see what happens. But maybe one of the last things, because I was actually supposed to talk a bit about emptiness. That's what I said before this talk. And now I just start sharing my story, because that's all I really know. I don't know much about emptiness. But the thing with my dad, what I told about, he had a burnout. And he read this book, Congratulations with Your Burnout. And he was like, what are these people talking about? Congratulations with your burnout? So this problem that I have is a good thing? And then I heard this other story of this woman. She was a hippie, you know, and she was Buddhist, and she had good practice. And then they were hitchhiking with her kids and her husband. And they stepped into this car with 2 guys. And down the road, the cops pulled them over, and the 2 guys in the car killed the cops and blamed the family. So what happened? The woman went to prison, her husband went to prison, the kids were taken away. The husband went completely nuts. He went crazy, yelling every day, I'm innocent, I'm innocent. And what did the woman? She said, okay, you know what? I own this situation. This is not a prison. This is a monastery. I'm not wearing this orange robes as a prisoner, but as a nun. And this is my practice. And she started meditating every day. And she didn't neglect her situation, you know. She kept working on it. And she kept dedicated to show that she was innocent. And then I have this third story related to that. Maybe you heard of the book Man's Search for Meaning from Viktor Frank. I really highly recommend it. And this situation is even worse. So my dad had a burnout. This woman was in prison. Her kids taken away. But he was in a concentration camp. And he lost everything. And he found that even in this concentration camp, where the situation is terrible, horrible, awful, we can't even imagine with our minds how terrible it would be, that he actually had the freedom to determine which meaning he gave to the situation. When the guards yelled at him, he could see them with compassion or he could see them with hatred. And he actually decided for compassion. And what these three things have in common, my dad seeing this book, Congratulations with Your Burnout, this woman in prison saying, okay, I'm in prison, but I decide that this is actually a monastery and I'm a nun. And this man being in a concentration camp and deciding that he's not in a concentration camp, he's there actually for spiritual practice. And everything that happens around him is a way for him to grow. And he started teaching other people in the concentration camp as well. And they found out that this great opportunity they had, even in the worst of times. And for me, this is really what emptiness means, you know? We give meaning to whatever we do in our lives. And for example, when I sit there and I drop my ball while having dinner, I can decide for myself, shit, oh, my attention is awful. Or I can just laugh at myself, you know? I'm making this big eye and I'm just laughing at myself making this big eye. And so whatever we do in life, whatever situation we encounter, if we are even in a concentration camp, in a jail, or we're having a burnout, we can decide to turn it around. And that is what emptiness is for me, you know? That we decide how we see a situation. And if we have that distance from our thoughts and our feelings and our emotions, we can do that. But if we are completely caught up in them, we believe them. And that is really what I experience here in the monastery, that, temple, monastery, that whatever we do, whatever situation we encounter in the Dharma room, outside while working, that we have the opportunity to do whatever we want to do with it. And we can make it something beautiful or we can make it something awful. And believe me, the first 2 weeks here were very awful for me because I decided that they were awful. But after that, I turned it around and now I feel very blissful, even though I'm working outside my ass off and it doesn't feel always so blissful. But I decided it's a great opportunity for growth. So I told you something about my life. I told you something about what I believe emptiness is for me, how it can work. And I hope, well, I did justice to this seed. And thank you for listening.